The last one speaker for the first day of the first year of the conference is actually the speaker who firstly accepted to be a speaker at the conference. It's a professor, Lutz Leidersdorf, who is a professor emeritus at the University of Amsterdam. He has published extensively in the system theory, social network analysis, sociometrics, and the sociology of innovation. My apologies. With Henry Edkowitz, he initiated a series of workshops, conferences, and special issues about the triple helix of university, industry, and government relations. He received the Direct Desola Prize Award for Sociometrics and Informatics in 2003 and held the City of Lausanne Honor Chair at the School of Economics, University of Lausanne in 2005. Since 2014, he is listed as a highly cited author by the ISI at Clarivate Analytics, of course. So I'm really glad that Lutz Leidersdorf actually accepted my invitation to be part of this conference. And actually, when we initially planned the conference, we planned that to organize in Amsterdam because we believed there we could find interesting speakers who can easily reach the Amsterdam as a final destination. And one of them was Lutz Leidersdorf, who is actually, if I understood well, actually very close to the initially planned venue of the event, which was Impact Amsterdam. So I'm really happy that, and eagerly waiting actually this presentation, and hopefully it will be enough interesting or even more as previous one today. So Lutz, you have 45 minutes for your complete presentation. Now I'm going to stop sharing my screen.
Okay, thank you.
You should try sharing your screen. So you have 45 minutes for the complete your presentation, including the questions. Please leave just a couple of minutes for the questions at the end.
That's not what I want. Thank you, Dragon. I accepted the invitation at the time immediately because you were planning the conference at more or less at my doorstep. It would be the first international conference to go by bike. Can you hear me? Let's check.
Yes, I can hear you very well.
Okay. So over time and in our conversations, the subject has changed a bit. Originally, I had in mind to give a very empirical presentation, but I'm working on a book. And in that context, I am also working. I'm best known as a sociometrician, but my interest is also in systems dynamics, triple helix relations, etc. So I thought that this was a very nice opportunity. I still think that it is a very, very nice opportunity to make a statement about the challenge of big data to the social sciences. Because I think it is very mistaken. And what I want to do is to replace the subject to the alternative of dualism and to explain again. And I know that some of you will find this much too philosophical. It's the end of the day, and I know it's a tiring day. You can go home between quotation marks, but I'll tell this, try to explain to you why this is so important for the social sciences. Monism is the fashion of the day. It is well known in Antonio Damasio, who made the first claim about it in his book Descartes' Error, and it stands against Descartes' exclamation or expression "cogito ergo sum," which we all probably had in high school. And about which Damasio in his programmatic book says, taken literally, the statement cogito ergo sum illustrates precisely why, precisely the opposite of what I believe to be true about the origins of mind and about the relation between mind and body. And it's strange to be in the position to defend Descartes, but I think it's a real misunderstanding to think that cogito ergo sum is an empirical statement. It is not an empirical statement. The empirical statement in Latin would be "it quod cogitat est," that what is, that what things is. But it is not the case. What Descartes wants to say is that before we can make any statement, we have to be reflexively aware that we can make statements. And that generates an empirical domain, of thinking, which is different from the body. And I'm going to make the claim that in more recent times, change of focus is possible, and I'm going to build on Husserl notably, which makes it possible also to do social sciences beyond what Descartes wanted. So Husserl, I mentioned, is in 1929, writes a book which is very nice to read. It is 120 pages only, Cartesian Meditations, where he goes back to Descartes to ask himself, what is it that we are doubting about? What is, in Latin, the cogitatum of the cogito? The cogito is us being uncertain about things and doubting about things. And in that cogito ergo sum, according to Descartes, the cogitatum, that what we are uncertain about, is God. Yeah, that's Descartes' time. But nowadays, Husserl, who is no longer religious, says, what is it that we are doubting about? And he comes up with, first we have to be aware that we are doubting, that it is psychology, but that we are doubting about what he calls intersubjective intentionality. And this basic notion of social, whatever it may be, a social logic or a social system, has been on the table by other authors as well. The American pragmatists are important here. Alfred Schütz, who criticizes Husserl, that he thinks that he can talk so abstract about it, and particularly what I'm going to focus about, I see there's a typo there, double contingency. Double contingency is from Parsons. Let me move this away if I can. Yeah, maybe I can move it completely away. That would be better. No, I'm not able to complete. Okay, it means this is what Parsons defines as double contingency. Ego expects alter and not God, but just an alter human being to entertain expectations as ego entertains them himself. And so in not in Latin, but in English, each of us expects the other to entertain expectations as we entertain them ourselves. So we are not talking about behavior. We are talking about people expecting each other. And this double contingency, Parsons then argues, is the micro foundation of intersubjective intentionality. It's a very different micro foundation from an economy where we have the homo economicus for the micro foundation who has preferences. The double contingency shapes the social endogenously. It means that all the social is eventually built up from expectations of us to ourselves. And it is questionable to call these things, these expectations, a system. It's more a logic, or in Husserl's term, a cogitatum. Why is it not a system? Because a system is something where we think that it is something. And precisely Descartes' point is that is res extensa, things which are like a table or a chair or us as human beings showing behavior. That's all res extensa. What we're interested in is res cogitans. How can we think about thinking, and how does thinking allow us to coordinate social systems, social structures? In the preparation on for this meeting, I wrote it more extensively in a paper which is available from SSRN. So for people who want to read it afterwards, with Franz Hoegel, and it is under review for the Systems Journal. But let me try to take it further from here. I have to. That what is not, but what could be, yeah, is what in information theory is equal to the redundancy. And this is from Brooks and Wiley to biologists in the book Evolution is Entropy. Here you see that in it's a model which they claim that if you take a long time, you take the biological system, the biological system grows, yeah, but the maximum capacity of the biological system grows even faster, and the difference between the two is redundancy, and the redundancy can grow even when the information grows, although both add up to the maximum information content or the maximum entropy. Yeah, most of you will be somewhat familiar with this notion of maximum entropy. And the point here is that we have this domain of redundancy, which is, from a biologist's point of view, historically not realized. It is not necessarily excluded, but that's how Brooks and Wiley say it. But we can technologically enlarge the redundancy. We can make things possible which haven't been possible before. And here, knowledge and science play an important role, because the creation of options is based on distinctions, on making more refined measurements, on making more states visible than we had before. So the consequence is that a system which develops in terms of redundancy is very different from a system which develops in terms of entropy or information. Notably, the entropy flow or the information flow is with the arrow of time. It's from the now to the future. While redundancy develops against the arrow of time, it's a very different thing. For example, we cannot easily specify what is the maximum entropy without theorizing. We can't know the maximum of something before we theorize it. And that includes that we also need to theoretically specify redundancy before we can measure it. The enormous beauty of the notion of redundancy is that we can measure it with information theory. So I'm going to talk about about what we are endowed, yeah, the cogitatum, which we cannot know without theorizing, but we can expect it. And we have made steps since Husserl and Parsons put it on the research agenda for the social sciences. And the three things which I want to point in this lecture is the notion of the theory and computation of anticipatory systems. The anticipatory system is a system which entertains a model of itself, and that model can be about the future state of the system. So here you see typically an anticipatory equation where the state at t plus one is the independent variable for the state at t. Yeah. So here we see that the arrow of time is being inverted. This is the traditional logistic equation. I'll come back to that in a moment to explain it in more detail. But you can see that we can also turn that around. And the solution is not just a minus sign. The solution is more complex than that. And this is actually the things which I want to bring together in my book. The other source which is relevant here, or the line of thought, is that the one about mutual redundancy among three or more interacting codes. I will explain that also in a moment. So you can also say that this is university-industry-government relations. It comes from that type of theorizing. There may be the generation of negative entropy, not in terms of in the institutions interacting, but in terms of the systems dynamics interacting. If we have science, industry, and government interacting at a more abstract level than of concrete institutions, we can have this formula for the entropy, for the information. I cannot fully explain that now, but most of you will be familiar with Shannon's age, yeah, the information content. If the information content is combined, then you get these terms, and you can see that if these negative terms are larger than the positive terms, that this can become negative. And a negative entropy is something which is also associated with against the arrow of time. And the theoretical framework, which is in the background, is Niklas Luhmann's work, who sets central. He, of course, some people say that if Luhmann says theory, he means Husserl. And indeed, it is important to see the relation there. That communication self-organizes meaning. And why is meaning so important? Because meaning is given to the events from the perspective of hindsight. That means also backward, yeah, and with reference to supra-individual horizons of meaning, that is forward. I'm going to try to explain you in these half hour or so all these concepts, so I have a busy agenda. Just as an appetizer, let me try to explain to you the focus is on communication with Luhmann. Communication can be repeated over time, so you get historical patterns in the communication, and you get meaning that which is provided from the perspective of hindsight, with the backward error. We can say after things happen, they have a meaning for us, and the meanings are codified with reference to various horizons of meaning. So what you say in one context has a different meaning than what you say in another context. For example, if you say there's a shortage of energy in a political context, then you are talking about energy carriers, oil, gas, wind energy. If you say that in a context of physics, then it means something very different, because energy is a conserved quantity. So things mean very different things in terms of different meanings. And in the communication structure, we have developed this differentiation among the meanings. I'm going now to take a step back to develop the model fully from the bottom, using Shannon's well-known, I hope most of you know that, communication channel. Yeah, this is Shannon's model. And Weaver, Shannon's co-author, says, similarly, one can imagine another box in the diagram, that there is a semantic element in this side and on that side. And the semantic elements, and that's not Weaver, but my contribution, are correlated, yeah? So there is a correlation in language, and these languages are the natural languages, but you can have specific codes in the communication which further develop. I mentioned just a moment ago the political system and the science system. So for example, Luhmann claims, I think that's completely right, but that the specific code in the communication in the science system is that there is an investigation whether things are true or not, and here whether things can be done or not. So you can have interactions, and among those different codes in the communication, you can have translations. And why is that now so important? It is this domain which we cannot observe. It's not there as things are, like a table or real facts, hard scientific facts, which we study from a monistic perspective, and we are here interested in things which we really have to puzzle in our mind before, like in a maths puzzle, before we can say something about them. So you get three layers. You get, I'll show that in a moment. First, you get the res cogitans and the res extensa. And we call that a double contingency, because it is you and me having a body and therefore also being contingent about each other in terms of behavior. But we can also, what we think is also contingent about each other. So I also have my own perspective, and you have your own perspective. And communication systems are discussing specific things which have different codes of communication in them, like eigenvectors, more or less. This comes basically from Herbert Simon. It's taken by Luhmann without a reference to Herbert Simon, so that we have we have the historical events, the historical interactions and the relations. We have the self-organization, for example, of the market or the sciences. And we have the organization and instantiation in the historical present. And this is taking place historically along trajectories. Yeah? Here you can speak of a regime or paradigm or whatever is for that system the right wording. The dynamics are very different. This is already indicated here. And here I'm going, I'm a bit hindered by this. I can't get it away. I don't know if you see it. Oh yes, I can get it away.
But I think if you go over your picture, you can say that hide that or something like that.
I think I got it away, yeah?
Okay.
So you get here an order of observables, yeah? There's information being developed here, necessarily positive. The model is recursive. We always grow from a previous state. And here we have just showed it an order which is based on expectations and which is driven as redundancy. And we call that hyper-incursive. Daniel Dubois has introduced this terminology because we also need the term incursive here. Here we have the situation that the expectations operate on the material so that we have the interface between the two of the cogitans and the extensa. I'll show you that in equations, which makes it clearer. This is the traditional biological model, the logistic equation, as most of you will be familiar with. And you have here the hyper-incursive equation. There can be no other system than the social system, which can have this double contingency. Cats and dogs and whales and monkeys may communicate, but we don't have any idea about a double contingency. We cannot understand it, what they do. And here we have an interesting case, which is very relevant for innovation studies. Actually, it's in the background of my own origin for this, because here you see that, for example, the technology builds on its previous state. I want to go back. How do I go? A technology builds on its previous states, but here is the selection mechanism, and the selection mechanism is not in the past, but is in the present. And these three equations have very different solutions. And that makes it important because we are inclined to think along the biological model, but this program of studies should be not metabiological, but anti-biological. I'll explain that in a moment. Some of you will be familiar with this picture. This is the logistic map, which becomes chaotic when the bifurcation parameter goes to 4. Doesn't matter if you are not familiar with it, because the main point which I want to make is this is typically a biological problem. If we add the incursive equation, then we can show that there is a line. This is here in this model now the psychology. And if we add the hyper-incursive equation, we get a quadratic equation and we get two solutions for values above 4. So you see the antagonism, yeah? Here you have the natural, the traditional way of thinking about it, which ends at 4, and culture, the cultural layer, the layer which is grounded in the future, in expectations, begins, points to 4 in the other way around. And if you take this as the weakly anticipatory system, which combines the body and the mind, then we have a model also here for future, the role of future states on the present. So In this part of my presentation, I have now focused on this differentiation, the vertical differentiation, the codification of meaning, how it comes from relations. So in the three layers built up, this is from Herbert, largely from Herbert Simon. What's added now is that we also have horizontal differentiation. Luhmann calls this systems differentiation and this social differentiation. And here, the triple helix model, particularly if you are not taking it as an institutional model, becomes important. Why is the triple helix model so important? Because a triple helix can be turned clockwise and counterclockwise. So it provides us with a model which we just saw, a model where we can have positive and negative values. And we combine and we have a trade-off between the two because we have both the self-organization of the sciences and the organization of the sciences. The historical organization and the non-historical but evolutionary dynamics at the above historical level. So we get an evolutionary dynamics and an historical, an evolutionary dynamics and an historical development. The trajectories at the development level is historical and the regime is pending as res cogitans. And our specification of this res cogitans provides us with new options. So you see, the dynamics is very different. Here you have the traditional one, time, uncertainty, production, historical, information, behavior, organization. And I added here the word phenotypical because it is the variation which we see here. Here we have genotypical. We don't see it, but we have to assume it if we want to think about it. So we have to hypothesize it. And we are excellently able to do that. And the operation is against time. So here you see my argument against monism, why monism is throwing this all away, with this domain of expectations, and wants only this. And I think that's really throwing away the child with the bathwater, because it is here that the knowledge-based economy is being shaped. I'm going back now to this argument about how it relates to information theory. I'm not sure, not everybody will be familiar with this, but the transmission between two informations, H1 and H2, is in the overlap. You can call that overlap the transmission, but also in this case, the redundancy. Yeah. So if you add it up, you would count this twice, so you have to subtract it. And in this case, the redundancy is equal, the overlap is equal to the transmission between the two. But in the case of C, you have seen it can be that there is a plus or a minus, and that depends on the configuration. And we can evaluate that numerically. If this is minus, then we have mainly redundancy generation, new options, and synergy. So the putting together of 1, 2, and 3, in this case, leaves provides us much more options and thus with synergy. Well, if the T1, 2, 3, that's the Shannon case, we have historical development, exploration, and realizations. Why is this now so important for centrometrics? For example, in evaluation, one looks at past performance. Past performance is historical, it's explorative, it's realizations. And we are interested not in past performance, but in future possibilities of performance. So a system which is highly successful in past performance, maybe at the end of its possibilities to grow further. And so T1 minus 0 is from this perspective then more desirable than the other way around. So you see, all our focus has been on past performance, and equally in evolutionary economics, for example, the idea is that what evolves is the firm, the entrepreneur who is taking the risk and that it is at the firm level. And from this perspective, we would say, what we see, the entrepreneur, the behavior of the firm, that's all phenotypical. What we're interested in is what is evolving in that. And I would say what is evolving, to immediately answer that question, is the codes of the communication and their interactions. Because their interactions among the codes, and what does this mean in terms of perhaps easier to follow, is to say, we are used to thinking that the data are interacting, the variation, but from this perspective, that's variations interacting. What we are interested here is in the selections, the selection environments, because these coordination mechanisms, these codes of communication, function as selection mechanisms. So what you can say at home, you can say in parliament, or you can say in court or in the university. So other things are being selected away on the basis of the codes. And these interacting codes generate options in addition to the information which is continuously produced by the entropy flow, because the selection mechanisms cannot operate if there's no variation. This was not meant to be. Let me see whether I can go back. Yeah. We recently did this as one of the several country studies have been done, and I picked up a recent one which I did with Harriet Ruhrmann, a student from Berlin, and we had done this before with Michael Fritsch, and Michael is also joining us in this team, where we asked ourselves, if you take three dimensions, three codes of not codes of communication necessarily, but three orthogonal dimensions. So we take the firms in Germany or another country, and we take as the three dimensions the technological competencies, as in the NACE code from the OECD, the regional, the zip codes, yeah, the postal codes in Dutch, and also we codify the size of the companies. And then we look at the interaction effects between these three codes. And then we see the question was, how far has the east-west divide in Germany disappeared? And you see, as you look at the NUTS 1 level, which is a measure of the OECD and the European Commission, then you see that it's still very pronouncedly the case, with the exception of Pommern, which always has been weak in producing these synergy, in which we now take as an indicator of the knowledge-based economy. But if you go at lower levels, particularly, you see that the picture has become more pronounced, more changed since the previous situation. To give you another example, and I'll come to a more textual example in a moment. Ping Zhu, and I did it for China using other types of data. The same type of data, Orbis data. And there you see that the eastern part of China is intensive in producing synergy. But interestingly enough, we then took it at a lower level, and independently of Ping, I said at a certain moment, we have four provinces which have this position, which are so synergetic. And then Ping said, who is Chinese, oh, but that's because precisely these four are the municipalities in China. That means that the government has a strong administrative say in these four provinces, more than the provincial administration. And precisely there, in Western Europe, I would not believe it, but in China, it may be the case that the government is successful in making the innovation environment in China working. Once you have, let me go back, just to, once you do that for three dimensions, you can also do it for four or for five, six, n dimensions, because you can take dimensions 3 by 3, each times 3, and everything which is more than 3 can be decomposed into triple helices. So if you have, there's a discussion in the literature whether one should go to quadruple helices or quintuple helices, and that doesn't matter because we can always reduce, decompose more dimensions into sets of 3. That's from network analysis. So here, you have, for example, you have a system with 4 variables. Each variable can be considered as one of the triple helices. It's just a simple model. You can take this one, but you can equally take this one, or that one. Yeah, and then you can see that you can have different triple helices. See, there's a mistake here. And you can evaluate which combination is most synergetic. And here I did that for the 4 options here. And you see that the yellow one, which originally was this one, 1, 2, and 3, is the most synergetic. And this, of course, is now very interesting, because if we associate synergy with the notion that new options are being created, then we can ask ourselves, where are the new options being created? And in the next picture, I did that for the citation environment of Scientometrics, the journal, which is here. And then you see that Scientometrics, in its citation patterns, has synergetic effects here on the main player is the American Economic Review, which you don't expect so much to play a role in the environment of Scientometrics, except via research policy, but research policy doesn't play so much a role. You can also then see that a set of network journals, but mainly management journals, which are the synergy partners for in the Scientometrics citation environment, and here a couple of computer science journals. So this is a very different picture from the cognitive dimensions which are here, which could also have been spelled out, and then we would have seen Scientometrics with science and technology journals like research policy, social studies of science, which may be here somewhere behind, and technological forecasting and social change, JSIS, Journal of Informatics. But these are not the ones highlighted if we ask this question: can we evaluate which of the combinations are most synergetic? So over the last half year or so, I have now developed a synergy indicator, which is available on my website. It is also mentioned in the paper, which I just mentioned, that is explained. Oh no, this is not a paper, which is also available. I can give you the references. If you look for synergy, you will find probably on my website easily which papers are most relevant. So the synergy indicator measures, I repeat here, the generation of additional redundancy. It strengthens the cultural evolution as a feedback mechanism on the underlying res extensa and the evolution of that system, the Darwinian evolution. Things get new meaning when we are looking in the cultural dimension than when we are looking historically, because, for example, the selection mechanisms are different. There's no natural selection. There are codes of communication which each select with their own selection criteria. The future options derive are more important for an innovation system than the past performance. And a very beautiful perspective. Example of that is elaborated by Kyun Lee. I don't know if he's in the audience. We met several times, where he shows that South Korea is not building on its past in terms of innovation, but it is building it grasps the innovation from a future perspective. For example, in relation to its position to China. I think this brings me pretty much to my conclusions and summary. Of course, I have covered too much ground, but perhaps it is a bit of an appetizer for you to listen a bit to this. What I wanted to stress is, again, cultural evolution is an evolution of expectations, and we are now beginning to be able see the way to make an way through to express as a redundancy, to model it also. And in one paper, Inge Ivanova and I said, there is a need of a calculus of redundancy as different from the traditional, but in coherence, of course, with the information theoretical calculus of Shannon. Yeah, I think that remains, as the cogitata then becomes important, because we cannot even specify the maximum entropy without theorizing. So the whole idea that you can do without theory of, leave theory behind and just use big data is, from this perspective, almost ununderstandable. If you want envisage this logic at the super individual level, generating redundancy, which is the basis also, I would claim, for the future orientation of a knowledge-based economy, then we are missing the point. The end of theory would reduce the social sciences to commentary of the natural sciences, and it is very much in our interest, and also very much in the interest of society, that we begin to think about these codes, which are not hardwired like the DNA in the biological system. These are not codes in the biology. These are codes in the communication. Not incidental that we use the word codes, and we have more than one of them, and the interacting codes generate the redundancy, as I have tried to argue. This, as I said, this sociological program of studies can be considered as anti-biological, not in the sense that I want to be against my colleagues who are biologists. In the background, I'm also a biochemist, but I mean programmatically, as an intellectual program, we need to claim autonomy for this program. And that's precisely what Husserl did for psychology and Parsons for sociology. We are here talking about how future states of the system can guide us in understanding the system. It is against historicism, because the historical development is only the morphogenesis, it's only the phenotypes which we can observe. What we need is those observations in relation to expectations, and the model, of course, is the chi square, where we always set observations in relation to expectations. So we shouldn't let us push back from the biological side in monistic programs. We need to stand for this because it is important. As a final slide, I mentioned my forthcoming book, Communication Theoretical Perspectives on the Dynamics of Meaning, Information and Discursive Knowledge. I'm still writing on that. It should be done by December 31. That's the deadline. And this paper, which is a short paper, which was on invitation by Biosystems about the social dynamics, it's under review, and it reads easily. People say they understand me better since they have read that paper. So if people are really interested, you find it easily at SSRN. This brings my presentation to an end. I'm going to stop sharing here.
Okay, Lot, thank you very, very much for an interesting presentation, and a little bit different than the rest of the presentations already done today at the conference. So I have basically one question. You mentioned a few times that cultural revolution, let's say, and the exchanges in the expectations. Do you think for today, social sciences and humanities, let's say researchers from that field, is the bigger problem that shift in minds? What can be researched today using that big data available over the internet? And is that a bigger problem, or the bigger problem is actually how to collect that data and work with them in some technical aspect? So is it a bigger problem that shift in mind, how you should work as a researcher today, or that skills necessary for the today, let's say, tools available at the market?
Yeah, in the big data, we focus on the data and not on the non-existing data. Yeah, and particularly also in network relations, there it is clear. People are not studying non-relations, yeah, structural holes a little bit, yeah. What is required is a change of perspective to what the zeros mean. The zeros play an important role, and the zeros are the manifestations. Of course, we need not to do only philosophy. We also don't need to do only data crunching. We need to bring those two together. And the way, what I have wished to argue today is that the way to do that, and I follow also someone like Terence Deacon in that, who argues the zeros, the redundancy, how can we specify that? How can we make something from that? And it is there. And that's what I have try to show now.
And do you think in the future that, let's say, we will have more collaborations between computer scientists and social sciences?
It's very difficult for them to shift their minds. Yeah, we in the social sciences, we live in fantasies. Yeah, we find it not difficult to entertain fantasies, wishes, and to think about all kinds of things which are non-tangibles. Yeah. It is very difficult for, I'm not optimistic about the computer scientists. Their education is hard-nosed, yeah? The competition is in terms of competences which you show off, which are, in my opinion, are only behavior, yeah? If I look at our field, yeah? Of course, my interest is precisely at the interface between doing I also want to do advanced things in with the computer, also do nice in the evening, nice things in cytometrics or whatever. But if I look at it from a perspective, and we just have an issue coming up about qualitative and quantitative science studies, you see that it's perhaps too strong to say that there's an impoverishment. It's very much data money driven by demand of the European Union and national governments for research evaluation. You can't say to a funding agency, yes, you're right, the past performance on this and this, that unit is great, but we think that they are at the end of the ladder. Maybe people are accepting that, but then you need legitimation, and it becomes very difficult to hold that up, to say we are interested not only in data, we are also interested in the failing data, in the missing data.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and here in Q&A box, we have okay. One question, but I think actually it was on your last slide. Can you recommend some literature to better understand this topic? Actually, I would suggest that the attendees to read your book. Yeah. I'm not sure whether it will be open access or where it will be published.
But... yes, it will be with Springer, and it will be with Springer Link, and most universities have access to Springer Link. And then it is in PDF, so then you can just see how you do. Okay. So it will be not too difficult to get it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, Prof. Leidersdorf, thank you very, very much for accepting to be part of this conference.
Thank you for this nice day.
Yeah, And this was the last part of today's program, actually. I hope to see a lot of you, actually, tomorrow in the morning at 9 o'clock when we will start the second day of the conference with a workshop which will be organized by Social Science and Humanities Open Cloud Project. So enjoy in the rest of the day. For some of you, I believe it's a good evening. For some of you,